We're Everclear.
Just your average band of losers and one-hit wonders.
Well, we're going to do one more song. And it's a song that... It's a favorite song the band's written to this point, I think. One of them is called Santa Monica. It's going to be on the new record.
I am still living with your ghost.
Over Christmas, we got added to Buzzbin. The video, the airplay, just kept up. I remember them calling me and telling me, you got a gold album. Are you kidding me? 3 weeks later, my A&R guy told me this. Your record just went platinum.
The Portland trio Everclear seems to be doing pretty well for itself.
I was just impressed with how fast you guys have risen to success.
Never seen so many cameras in my life.
Our next guests are a great rock and roll band from Portland, Oregon. I listen to these boys every day. Here they are, Everclear.
This is just like a dream. All I've heard about for the last 2 weeks is livid, livid, livid.
We could live beside the ocean.
Gentlemen, Everclear.
Please welcome
Everclear.
And that's why we love Everclear.
Everclear, I've never seen Everclear play, but I think their record's really good, so I'm excited to see it.
I know that you've been told by so many fans over the years how that record got them through different or difficult times in their lives.
Still do. It kind of blows me away. You know, I was very honest on that record, as I am on all my records. You know this. And talking about my addiction issues, I've been clean and sober 32 years. But at the time when that record came out, I was sober 5 years. You know, and 5 years is, that's dicey. People get cocky at 5 years. And there was a lot of conflicts with my sobriety and being monogamous and being married and having a child for the first time and what all those experiences were. And I wrote about all those experiences, and they really connected with people, not just people that had the same experiences, but people, even kids, high school kids.
I write my songs for myself. It's not really like I'm trying to convey a message. I think I'm just trying to articulate what I'm feeling inside.
I've had people tell me because it just sounded honest and real, that's why it connected with them so hard. So I think that's a large part of it.
I don't think you can play rock and roll and make it fresh. I think most bands have about 5 to 6 albums in them, and they should pretty much call it a day. I see us putting out about 3 or 4 more records.
Let me talk about the subsequent pressure and anxiety to record a follow-up to Sparkle and Fade.
I went into it just with the idea of, like, I'm going to write a record. It's going to be harder than the last record. I'm going to call it Pure White Evil. And that's basically what I did. I sent it to my A&R guy, Perry, and he listened to it. And then we talked, and he goes, well, Arthur, it's a good record, but it's not a great record. And you can do better. I knew he was right. I just stayed in New York for 2 weeks and had my acoustic guitar in my hotel room, and I just started writing songs. It came together, and I called everybody, got them on the phone, and said, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do this, we're gonna go and record new songs, remix everything. We got it finished in June of 97. It came out in October of 97, and it went on to become pretty close to triple platinum. I actually got nominated for a Grammy for that record. Didn't win, but to be nominated is pretty awesome. And I did it my way, and I produced it. And there was a sense of satisfaction to do it myself. You know, and to fall, stumble a little bit, be able to pick myself up. That's a great lesson for everybody, to be able to fall down and get back up again.
When they scored their first big hit in 1995, Everclear was dismissed as a one-hit wonder. Well, 4 years and five hits later, the rock band is now having the last laugh. In fact, last month, the trio won Billboard's Modern Rock Artist of the Year. 7 years after they formed in Portland, Oregon, Everclear is everywhere.
I want to thank the fans for sticking with us. Thank you.
This is great now. It's going to be great while it lasts. It only lasts for so long.
Father of Mine is another one of those songs that not only was a huge hit, but so many people, so many young adults and youth related so much to that song. Talk to me about that.
Well, you know, it's funny about that song. I remember putting my daughter to sleep. You've got daughters.
Yes.
And parents, a lot of times, we'll just watch their kids sleep. You ever do that?
Yeah.
You just watch them sleep.
Yeah.
And it's magical. And I remember watching her sleep and just going, man, how does a man walk away from that? How do you do that? Because I'm not trying to be mean to my father, but I don't understand how you walk away from that. And I went to my office in my house in Portland and just started writing down things and playing riffs, and I stayed up all night. By the time I came to bed about 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning, I pretty much had a song. And woke up later that day and recorded it. And then about 2 weeks later, I went down to Capitol Records to see my A&R guy. Now, I didn't do demos. Most people at the time, they had to do what the label told them. I didn't do that. Perry's like, well, you got anything you can tell me about or play me or whatever? I go, I got this song I wrote called Father of Mine. He had a guitar in his office. I go, you want to hear it? So I play it for him. And, you know, Perry at the time was like a 45-year-old English guy, very staid, very proper. But I could see him tearing up a little bit. But then we hear the sound out in the front where the, you know, the Capitol's the round building, right?
Yes.
And the desks are out. Yeah. Outside of his office, and we go out there, and his assistant and three other girls are hugging each other, crying on the desk.
Yeah,
and he goes, well, I don't know if it's a single, but it's definitely going on the record. And I'm like, okay.
It's just amazing. I love that. It's so cool.